until it's about 135 degrees, which is quite blushed with pink. Mm-hmm. There we are.
Look at that.
It's really, it's not bad.
It's not bad. That's a beautiful, it's a really dark mahogany color.
It's luscious looking. Mm. And pan sauce is already halfway there. Mm-hmm. We're going to just add some broth. Could you put this into the turned off oven, mm-hmm, and turn the door up or close the door so it's open a couple of inches? If you were going to keep it for more than about 20 minutes, you might want to tent it with foil. Mm-hmm. But the idea is now letting it rest. Mm-hmm. Now, up goes the heat. Okay. And making a pan sauce, this is sort of standard procedure.
This is Italian procedure.
Yeah. Broth. Mm-hmm. And I'm using a poultry meat stock that's a very traditional stock in Emilia-Romagna. But you could use a good chicken broth if you have a veal stock. Or
you could have a little lamb.
You certainly could. If you took some of those bones that I removed and you cooked with some aromatic vegetables.
Now, this is so important. That's something they always do in French cooking, is the glazing.
Exactly.
All that concentrated flavor.
You know, I view this as a system. You keep basting this with the flavor, with the red wine. You add the olives, that brings more taste. But you keep returning flavor to the meat. And whatever the meat is left in the pan, you're going to give back to it in the form of the sauce. And you never, ever, ever waste anything.
You never throw away flavor.
God forbid. Now, a little bit of tomato paste. And I like it in a tube because it doesn't go bad.
Yeah.
It gives a little flavor, it gives body, and not very much, though. You don't need a lot of it. Mm. And I'm going to boil this down. I want to do a reduction. This is not a sauce that's going to drown the meat.
Mm.
A few spoonfuls to moisten it, and that's it. I think I'm going to give it one more taste.
Oh.
Yeah, I tend to think, oh yes, I like this dish. I'm going to just take this in here. I don't think we should ever cook food that we don't enjoy eating.
Oh, no.
You hear people saying, well, giving a dinner party and I'm going to make this dish or that dish because someone else likes it. And I'm absolutely convinced that if you don't love your cooking, it's just not going to work.
Oh, I
would agree. Now, keep this over here and it'll keep warm. And we're going to very quickly put together a dish of green beans with mortadella. Oh. And this is a very old dish from Bologna. It's very simple to do, and most people don't realize, I'm going to give this a dab of olive oil, how good mortadella is to cook with. Now, this is mortadella. This is the great granddaddy of bologna, as we know it. And it's from all over Italy, but Bologna is particularly famous for mortadella. And what we want to do is take a bit of it. I'm going to remove the skin. And you want it in a thick slice. You know, there, this is served as an hors d'oeuvre.
Oh, you'll thick slices.
Thick pieces that are cut like this, and they're put on a toothpick, and you nibble on them. And it's really a pork mousse. And I'm going to just cut this.
This is made in the USA.
This would have to be, because we're not allowed to import this from Bologna. But it's a very good one. And when you taste this, it should taste quite smooth and lush and have a subtle hint of cinnamon and the clove and the black pepper that's used to make it. Now, fairly high heat. And what I'd like to do, here's my spatula, is just saute that lightly. I want to release the flavor of the mortadella. And we've got a pound of green beans. And these have been pre-cooked. And you could even have done this yesterday for today.
Mm-hmm.
And I've rinsed them with cold water to stop the
cooking. They're beautiful greens.
Yeah, they really are. And you know, we tend to like our things very, very crisp, but in Italy they're a bit more done. And
I don't like things crunchily undercooked. I like them being either raw or cooked.
You sure not Italian?
No. Partly Norwegian and partly French, in spirit.
In spirit.
But otherwise, early American.
I think somewhere deep down in that spirit, there's also a sense of Italy.
Well, it might be. This is a good idea to bring out the flavor first, isn't it? Because if you just scattered it in, you wouldn't be getting the flavor.
You want to activate this, and you can use a bit less if you'd like. Mm-hmm. But this is a very interesting thing that I learned in cooking in Emilia-Romagna, of using some of these wonderful cured pork foods like mortadella, mm-hmm. prosciutto, in small quantities to flavor dishes, mm-hmm. not in large quantities. Mm-hmm. Isn't it?
It's much better hot than cold, I think. Really.
I think you're right. It is. Mm-hmm. Why don't we sit here and just have sautéed mortadella? Okay, now, in go the beans.
What's that, about a pound and a half of beans?
About a pound and a quarter.
Mm-hmm.
And I say,
don't really, measurements aren't terribly important.
No, what we want to do is just make sure that we have enough food that no one should want at our table. Mm-hmm. And I'm Italian, and to me, you always have more than enough.
Mm-hmm.
There. Half a cup of toasted walnuts that you've just broken. And toasted about 350 degrees for maybe 5 or 10 minutes. That brings out the flavor of the nuts. Mm-hmm. And nuts are harvested in the fall. So I stock up on them in the autumn and stick them in the freezer.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, because they can sort of start to go rancid. But I also find that when they've been in the freezer for a while, they need to be toasted before you use them. So, let's leave that over low heat.
Mm-hmm.
Could you hand me the lamp?
Could and would.
All right. And I'm going to take this.
Over here?
Right over here, please. Thank you. First of all, we want to get rid of all of this corning, which has done its job.
That really helped very nicely, didn't it?
It really did. It really did. And now this will go. That's hot.
It's very nice having the bowl as a handle, isn't it?
Yeah, and this is something where, if you can, have the butcher do what is called finching, which is trimming the meat down and cleaning
that nice bowl. Yeah.
What we'll do is we'll take the green beans. Okay, now, let's do... Could I ask you to flip off that burner?
Mm-hmm.
Let's do this. I think this is... I'm not someone who's a lot of garnishing. I think food is its own garnish.
Mm.
And I think taking this out with its own side dish... Normally, it's...
And that makes the garnish, I say.
There we are. And now the sauce with the black olives.
Mm.
And then you hold a little bit back so that when you carve at the table, you can put this in a pretty sauce boat. You spoon just a little bit over each thing.
I'll be interested in which method you use for carving a leg of lamb.
Well, I use two methods. I use the French method, which is carving this way. And we get these lovely long slices, and this does look good. We get all that nice flavoring, and you can go right down in. And this I like to use when you have people at the table, someone who likes it underdone, someone else who likes it a little more done, because you're going through the meat, and you're starting at the top, of course, which is more done. I use the American method, which is essentially going down to the bone. I'm going to start down here, like this. Scooping under, I'm just running the knife along the bone like this. So you really are loosening meat. And then you cut straight down, like so, or like so, for people who want to have the whole spectrum of what lamb tastes like. My personal, this is coming off. This never comes off, I think, quite as well as the French method. And my preference is to just carve away using that French method.
Mm-hmm.
So I will continue going down like so.
Nice long, sharp knife.
Yeah, and this is what you need. You need a good carving.
It's beautifully done. I'm going to say, because it's nice and pink.
Yeah, and it is flavored. You can see how the flavor's permeated all the way down. I'm going to put some green beans on the plate like so. This is now where the sauce enters into the picture, and all we want to do is just give everyone a few of the olives. And that is essentially the dish. It's very, very
nice,
simple.
Nice big serving for meat lovers. How many people do you think this?
Easily 6 to 8. But I love to have leftover lamb because what I do is I serve it thinly sliced the next day, room temperature, with a little bit of balsamic vinegar on it. As almost a salad. It's delicious. It's delicious. So this is lamb in the style of the Renaissance.
Well, this is lovely. Lynn, thank you very much. This has
thank
been
you.
A great lesson in lamb cookery and everything else. Thank you.
Julie's got the tasty.